here.
It smells like the ocean, salt water.
Let me do my music.
R&B pioneers Jodeci accredited with providing the blueprint for contemporary vocal groups. Dalvin, Devontae, Casey and JoJo were the antithesis of the clean-cut wholesome boy bands of the early 90s. Hailing from North Carolina, the original Bad Boys of R&B released three platinum albums and won numerous awards during their five-year reign, and paved the way for the likes of 112, Drew Hill, Jagged Edge and B2K with their irresistible formula of suggestive lyrics and thuggish street style. After 12 years away from the spotlight, Jodeci are set to return with fresh material and reclaim their status as R&B royalty. The Bad Boys are most definitely back in town, exclusively for MTV Bass.
So after 10 years away from our screens, away from our concert halls, you finally got back together. And that's why we're happy to be the first people to do an interview of you, a televised interview of you guys together. Okay. But I want to go right back. I just you know what I mean? Just for everyone watching, I want to take it right back. You're from North Carolina. Charlotte, where I don't know how many famous singers came out of Charlotte, North Carolina. Were there any?
No more.
So it was really exciting for you at the time. I mean, to come from there and to get signed and develop in New York. Tell me the story.
It was like a...
like a fairy tale, man.
Yeah, I mean, how we really got started, we both started with two sets of brothers in case people don't know. Me and Devontae are brothers, and Casey and JoJo.
Yeah.
And we came together. I'm just going to give you the cliff notes of it. We came together, you know, we was in two separate gospel groups, you know, young, and we both famous around, like, North Carolina and like, the gospel touring circuit. And we had always heard about each other, but we never really
met. Never met.
And they was working with a girl gospel group called...
Unity,
and you know, it was with me and Devontae. And so Devontae was dating one of the girls at the time, and Casey was dating one of the girls of the group. It was a four-girl group. And they always wanted us to meet each other. Y'all should hook up and do something with these two brothers, Casey and JoJo. And we was like, all right. So one night, they actually decided to link us up. And we went by Casey and JoJo's rehearsal, and...
Tell them why.
Well, he thought one of us was talking to his girl.
Okay, man. There you go.
And so I was like, man, these guys are crazy, man. And Devontae's like, nah, man, you know, let's check them out. I was like, nah, I'm good. But Devontae stayed there with him, and him and JoJo went in the studio the same night, started working on a song.
Actually, dog, what really happened, I hear a piano playing, and I hear my brother's voice. And it just happened to be JoJo and Devontae. So I'm like, man, we don't need to be doing this, man. Let's start a group.
Come on. Come and talk to me.
So you two connected on one level.
While they were outside beefing, we were in the studio recording. Yeah. We weren't even paying attention to them.
Now, that's not a manufactured group. That's a group that got together properly organically. That's a great story.
Yeah, then, you know, from then on, it was
now
like,
we best friends.
Yeah. And then on, it was like, you know, I actually didn't, Eve still didn't come around for a long time. I was like, man, that's crazy. Yeah. So, I don't know how. We just started hanging every single day.
Every day since then.
And Devontae moved all this little studio in Casey in the basement. Yeah. And they started writing and working. The girl Devontae was dating was actually doing a duet on Come and Talk to Me.
The original Come and Talk to Me.
The first time we recorded, she came to New York. Yeah. And it was a duet between her and KC, because she was the lead singer of their group.
Right.
And it got scrapped somewhere along the way. And KC ended up singing the second verse, but she was actually supposed to
sing.
She actually sung it with a recorder, and her sister came in and asked for us a royalty.
Yeah, she didn't say royalty.
Yeah, the first time we recorded, her sister's like, my sister needs her sororities. He's like, what are you talking about? She was talking about royalties. She didn't try to say it was a lot of work.
But she was right, though.
She was on the right track.
She was on the right track.
Come and talk to me, my baby. I really wanna meet you. Can I talk to you?
Okay, the gospel background, which is essential when it comes to integrity as singers. You know what I mean? Every great singer has a gospel background, it seems. Yeah. Oh, and the fact that you guys were the most rock and roll male band in black music in years and years and years and came from gospel always made me feel that's a bit strange. You know what I mean? But you do have a grounding, don't you? A church grounding.
Oh, yeah. My first professional gospel album, I recorded when I was 11 years old.
Wow.
And up until the age of 15, 16.
So you were really born to be a singer in the story.
That's what I see.
Devontae, I want to pick up with you now because the trip from North Carolina to New York must have been a very important one in your life in the sense of your career and the whole Uptown situation. Can you tell us a little bit about getting that deal and how it developed?
Getting that deal, well, this was one day I was sitting around, we did a demo, like 29 songs. I said, you know what, I'm going to New York. And we're going to get signed. We had been telling people we were going to get signed anyway. Yeah. We signed Uptown Records. That was on the back of God. And I'll be sure I know if you remember God.
Yeah, yeah, another group.
And they all signed Uptown Records. So that was a label we really liked because all groups were there. So we used to tell people, we're going to sign. We signed Uptown, whatever. So one day we got the songs done. And I said, I'm leaving to go to New York. And everybody thought I was playing. Casey said, you ain't going nowhere, whatever. So at the end of the day, we all decided, okay, we're going to leave. I broke out, went to New York. In the first 45 minutes, I just talked my way in the door. We sat down, whatever. They didn't want to hear us. But I said, look, we're not driving back home. You got to sign us. Go get the president, whatever, whatever. He came in, we got signed, to make a long story short.
Really? Just like that on the spot?
Just like that.
And you were on your own?
Yeah, it was just us. That's
four. Oh, you, the four of you walked in. Yeah,
we scraped up $300.
$300. We went there, went to New York. That was it.
You met Andre Harrell.
You
had to perform in front of him.
Yeah.
Because that's a typical thing. You stand there and acapella, show me
actually,
something.
Actually, the A&R fell asleep on our demo. Yeah. So good,
he told me. Right.
He said, y'all need to go back to North Carolina and do this over, then come back.
Y'all need to sound like Jeff Ray, who's an artist that
I remember
we ended up working with.
We were like, man, we don't do that kind of music. You know, our music is more gospel, like.
But what happened after that was changed everything. You know, I mean, not just for you as a group, but changed the way groups were viewed after that. Because up until you guys came along, you had guys in suits still trying to look real smart. And, you know, even Bobby Brown was wearing a couple of his videos a suit. And, you know, the attitude was swing beat is kind of squeaky clean, middle class. Hip hop is rap is that dirty stuff of the street.
Right.
And somehow, Jodeci combined both.
I'm gonna tell you why, man, because we wanted our image to be like, say for instance, you got four of your homeboys on the corner singing, you know, for you and your girl and all that, you know. We wanted to look like that, like in the ghetto, you know what I'm saying? The pants sag, hat to the back, everything. So we didn't want to come out there squeaky clean, you know what I'm saying? But, we just stuck with it, you know.
Even when we did gospel, we never wore suits. We did a gospel show before we left the dude. You see one big one that we had on shorts, tapes, you know what I'm saying? Everybody, we was like, we're not gonna be the same. We just gonna be us. And we knew, like, it's not a rag comedy. It's not like nobody makes us who we are. We know who we are. We know what we do. You know what I'm saying? Casey know what he adds to the group. I know what I add. So we don't need to be manufactured, processed. We don't need none of that stuff. We just go on with us for and do what we do. Without the suits, this is what we do.
But you went to the right label. They were the hippest label at the time.
Any label we go to, we had the same attitude.
You may not have got away with it at other labels.
Well, no, we would have. They didn't want us to do it.
Oh, they didn't want
us to do it. Even when the album came, the first thing we argued.
So when you hear people saying, oh, man, because Uptown got them styling,
that wasn't the case at all. So until they saw it work.
What happened was Dre, actually, when he gave us the money to go get the wardrobe budget, he thought we'd come back with suits. He thought we was coming back. We came back with the black jeans, and he was like, whoa, whoa, whoa. But our budget was ate up, so there wasn't nothing they could do about it.
Break it down right here. The girls in the crew get served and they got to. What up, D? I think you want to rap to. What up, D? I think you want to rap to. Yo, man, you ain't a sore, guess I pay you a visit. I guess I bring a demon while I kick double and six. Ideas and agendas ought to get you out wet. Yes, I do, cause I gotta give a f*** about sex. I pass ass like Mr.
What's your first video you looked at and you thought, yeah, that's the one, that's
the
one.
It was Gotta Love. I like Gotta Love. You know, I read County Fathers on it because they wanted Fat My Lady.
And the song, they didn't push it.
And they thought they had us because they went and bought, you know, we got the white suits. We cut the legs out. You go back and watch, we made them to shorts. We put boots on. They bought these nice white suits and we just altered them, cut them up.
Yeah, if you watch Fat My Lady.
Yeah, so it's like, okay, well, we'll try it y'all way, but we still going to put our twist on it. You know, they...
I'm gonna get some of the production that you did, which is amazing, especially in those days. But Gotta Love was the first record I heard of you guys, and I thought, you know, I heard Guy, you know, the whole Teddy era was big. When I heard Gotta Love, I was very excited, because men, you know, we like dancing to those sort of tunes.
Thanks.
And then I heard some ballads coming, and I was like, no, more Gotta Love, I need more Gotta Love. You know, and I was being honest, back in the day, you know, guys were like, give me something I can rock to. Incredibly successful, and one of the only bands that guys were saying, I like when that group sings ballads. You know, you didn't get that from a lot of guys. No. You know, girls, yeah, take it for granted. But Forever My Lady was just a seminal record. It did 3 million copies for you. It must have changed your life. What was the change like from North Carolina to 3 million sales for a debut album?
Amazing. Like, just, you know, to see your songs come to life, everybody singing.
Yeah, especially guys, man. And I think the guys felt Jodeci because I could relate to them. Mm. You know what I'm saying? Them guys, they not trying to be pretty. You know what I mean? I mean, they got an edge with them. Mm. They not trying to do all them dance steps and trying to look pretty for the girls. I think that's why the guys took into us.
Guys will be bringing their girls to your shows. Particularly you, Dalvin, right? Back in the day. I saw guys forced to bring their girls to your show and they didn't mind. Mm. It was the only show that they kind of didn't mind. The girls were screaming and everything. The guys were standing and I'm feeling
because they can relate to us.
I'm feeling
the music. We look just like them.
Yeah, we look like them.
Yeah, yeah.
Puffy was an intern. He was there being a cheerleader and watching how we was doing on stage. That's how he was able to go on stage and entertain from watching us.
Friday nights are gonna free for the video ring.
Okay, it was a signature sound that you had. It was so heavy, it was, you know what I mean? What was special about the production?
I mean, it's the vocals and the chord changes and how we just approach songs. Like, when I go to write a song, I'm not writing like Usher or anybody that writes for these people or what they're doing. You know, I'm not trying to keep up with the times of the day. I'm just speaking straight to the girl. Real simple, like, you listen to our records, it's real simple, and it's just there. And that's what we do. Ain't none of that tricky gang of words in a verse where you gotta remember a thousand. Nobody here could tell me the words to confession. You know what I'm saying? They might know the hook or these are my confessions, but it's so many words, like, okay, cool. Jodeci stick to a form. on, man. We just hit you straight. That's what it is.
Straight to the
it's 7 minutes straight. KC gonna deliver it and put the soul in it. I'm gonna write the words. He gonna put the soul in it. And whatever he gonna deliver it, make you feel it. Jodeci ain't just elevate R&B. We elevated hip-hop. Like, before Jodeci, you didn't see no hip-hoppers with tattoos, two earrings. Like, go check all the old records. There's none of that. Jodeci came out, we introduced a lot of stuff to the game. More than just music, we introduced a chapter, everything, a lot of stuff.
Nah, it's true, fashion. It's true.
So now you look at 50 Eminem, that's all a product of Jodeci era, not Boyz II Men, nobody else.
Baby, I'm waiting for you to come back to love.
Say this to the guys before we start the interview. I said, you got to understand, when Jodeci came out, artists weren't being endorsed the way they're being endorsed now.
Right.
You know, you just, you know what I mean?
Right.
The image, the impression you had, like you say, with the tattoos for an R&B group
right.
as well.
Right.
You know, the influence an R&B group had on hip-hop, because it's normally the other way around. Everyone
right.
says,
right.
Ah, hip-hop influenced R&B, right. the beats, the this, the that, the age.
Right.
But you did it, with, you're right.
Yeah,
right. And you had rappers trying to jump on your tracks.
Right. Right.
All day, every day, probably. Now, how did you resist the call that everyone was saying, I want a piece of Jodeci, I want a piece of... Because you guys were so hot. When you came to the UK, I mean, everyone was chasing you like you were the superstars. You hadn't even sold Big Hair yet, but you had such a cult following. You know, this hence why we're talking to you now, because you never sold a million records here.
Right.
But when you turned up, you would have thought you did.
Yeah, because they feel like they could touch us. You know what I'm saying? That's what it is. They're like, man, I could... It's like, I'm the same way. If I see an act, I'll be like, man... Something about that group or something about that act right there, I feel like I can relate to them, I can touch them. They don't act all stuck up, uppity, you know what I'm saying? And I think people can feel that when we on stage and on our records too, you know, by our lyrics, you know, by our arrangements, our beats and all that. So that's what, to ask your question, what it is, people can touch us, man. That makes us feel good. Cause I gotta say, man, we don't look at ourselves as stars. I mean, we respect who we are, but y'all got a little saying, man, you know what I mean? Don't call me a star. You can't touch a star, but you can touch me.
Right.
Bad boy. Come out and play.
I know we had to do a remix, right?
Now, you work with some great people. You've been on tour, you've been associated to, you know, at the start when Puffy was just a fledgling, you know, guy in a record company, he was working with you guys. What was that relationship like? Because I can imagine that must have been a little bit,
well, to be honest, Puffy was an intern at Uptown Records. And Puffy ran around, did a lot of things, learned a lot of stuff. From Jodeci, from watching us on stage, he was just an intern. So they cut all the, what Puffy do with y'all, he was there being a cheerleader and watching how we was doing on stage. That's how he was able to go on stage and entertain from watching us.
Yeah, watching us.
We've been doing this from kids. Puffy worked at the label.
Does it sometimes upset you that people seem to have it the other way around?
No, we don't care. Like, we do it,
we know
it comes out. Like,
we know the truth.
You know what I'm saying? Like, whatever. You know, I'm happy and glad it works for Puffy.
Take my money, my house and my car, for one hit of you can have it all, baby. Cause making love every time we do, girl, it burns their drugs. Cause I'm an addict of you, and you know.
Bands at the time, because while you were hot, there was a band on the real mainstream, Boyz II Men, that were in their clean cut shorts, no tattoos.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? Singing to the middle America,
right.
in a sense,
right.
like an old Motown group would.
Right. I mean, you know, we respect Boyz II Men, they respect us. You know, back in the day, they respected us too. But it was like that was like night and day.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? It didn't really bother us when people would. I'm gonna be honest, Boyz II Men did get a lot of mainstream more attention than us, you know, but we weren't worried about that. Our audience was. I ordered them guys on the corner. They got their girls with them with the big earrings on. You know, that was our audience. That's what we had to get first. First, you got to get the streets first. That's our thing. If you get the streets, you there forever.
Cool, this place, came the second album. What's the thought process between you guys going into that record? Because you're under pressure now. You've had a hit album.
Really, well, it was a lot easier because we was having fun doing it. You know, it was Ritz, like I said, it was Ritz. Everybody was just having fun. It just took a little longer to make because everybody was just, you know, enjoying the long touring process of the first album and, you know, all the promotionals and everything. So going into this one was just a lot easier. You know, we just went in there and sat down and whatever came out, it was what it was.
And you delivered another street classic, really. Your audience didn't run away. They embraced right. the record again. And at that point, it was like Jodeci had a signature sound, definitely.
Yeah.
But there was rumors. People started saying, oh, the group are going to split up surely because, you know, the brothers sing, the other guys produce. You know what I mean? There was a dynamic your group had, right. But it led to the media talking a lot about things that they didn't know.
Right, exactly. Everybody in this group knew what part they played. Mm. You know what I'm saying? I mean, everybody know these are the producers. I can't produce nothing, you know. Joda can't produce anything, you know. And it's like everybody knew that Casey and Joda do most of the singing. I mean, we knew that, so we didn't care when people said stuff like, they're gonna break up one day because Casey gonna wanna go solo, or Devontae gonna wanna just move on and do his own thing as producer. We didn't look at it like that, because when we met each other, we all were doing the same thing we're doing now.
Time for you guys when it was really bad in terms of you're with a group for a long time, you're from the same part of the world, mm-hmm. You're brothers.
Yeah,
there's a lot, you know. Listen, I don't love my sister every day, mm-hmm. But I don't have to work with her every day.
I feel you on that.
No, you understand what I'm saying?
I feel
but
you
I love
on
her,
that.
But I can't love her every day.
I feel you on
that. You know what I mean? But I don't have to work with her. Now, two sets of brothers working together overnight, staying in hotels, on tour, producing a record, having meetings about their business, it's got to be a strain.
Mm-mm. Well, business, we all be on one accord at all time. That's number one rule. We're gonna be in business together at all time. But for all like the person behind the scenes, this is my boy right here, and JoJo his boy. So
wait, this one like the women with each other. Me and JoJo don't fuck with these kids. It's that simple.
So it's like my person.
So you're like brothers, but you're mixed.
Yeah, we mixed.
So we having each other's back. Really? Me and JoJo be on the same.
Yeah.
Really like that. So no, in the creative process, honestly, when you come with some songs, Casey, you know, I've seen Casey perform. Yeah. I know his style. You know, he don't move too much, he don't have to. You know what I mean? Just takes the top off, moves down, sings for the song, and people lose their mind. It's quite simple. It's
and
quite a simple
have
process.
Any muscles.
So when you come with a song, you go, Casey, you want to sing this song? This song's great. And he says, I don't like it.
Yeah.
It's not me.
Right.
Did that ever happen?
No, I mean, the only thing that happened like that is Casey might say, it's the Georgia more dude, but he will try it because he know I know them. So if I say, Casey, you can do it, he would say, all right. Because we prefer, we do it. Like, this is what we do. But at the end of the day, if he ain't funny, he'd be like, yeah, I think JoJo can sing it better, so JoJo will try it. But normally, it's going one of them could do it.
Has its longevity or its time span, particularly when you're seen as a male group mm-hmm. or a female group. Mm-hmm. People always say, well, they're going to last two albums. They get 2 albums because then, you know, the girls don't like them when they get older and stuff. Right. You know that kind of thing. Right. You did 3 albums. Mm-hmm. Are you happy with all 3 albums that you guys did?
We're blessed.
I mean, they're down. They're in the Hall of Fame.
We're blessed. Thanks.
But then it stopped. Mm-hmm. And you went off and did different projects. And so much has been written down.
Right.
I mean, I could go on a website, I'm going to the internet now and get 20 different stories about the same thing.
Different magazines.
You know what I'm saying?
How that came about, man, actually, it was Devontae's idea. I remember one night he was in my mom's basement, and Devontae said, hey, man, if Josie ever blow up, he said, I want you and Josie. He said, let's stop, and I want you and Joe to do a duet album. So, that was his idea, man, for the KC and JoJo, for us just branch off a little bit. So, but we knew the world was gonna think that, you know, we've broken up, but we never broke up, man, ever.
But you haven't heard an album from JoJo in 10 years, last 5 years, 6 years, we've been with each other straight every day.
Every day.
We'd rather kick it, like, we family. This is something we just do. You know what I'm saying?
They used to come to the studio. Dalvin and Devontae just come to the studio while me and JoJo was recording KC and JoJo and tell them, give us pointers. Mm-hmm. So it's still like we were still together.
Right.
I really love you.
Was an enormous record for you, an enormous record.
Yeah.
In a sense, part of me, I was happy for you, really happy for you. I kind of wanted Jodeci's name on it because I just wanted to see Jodeci at number one.
Hey.
You know what I'm saying?
But Devontae, we used on that album. You did a song on that album.
So, I mean, that must have been a strange feeling for you because when you're doing performing with your brother, without the other two guys,
that's true.
You could feel the audience thinking they're going to walk out any minute.
That first CD, it did feel funny, man. But see, that just goes to show you the impact that Jodeci put on the world. If they can accept just one, two, or just three together, that's a strong impact on the, oh, man, that's part of Jodeci, man. I got to support that. You know what I mean? So, that's how I look at it, you know. I wasn't looking at it like, I mean, I was nervous the first night, trust me. I was nervous the first day in the studio because I'm not used to nobody else telling me, you know, what to sing and how to sing it, except for Dalvin and Devontae. So me and JoJo, we was nervous at first, man. But then when they started coming around, saying, oh, man, that's tight. So it was like, I guess it's tight. If they said it's tight, it's tight.
Solo things in some way or another. Dalvin, you had your projects as well. How was that for you?
It's cool. I mean, I just like making music, man. You know, performing is what I do. That's what I like doing.
Was that a situation of, well, them guys have got a record, I've got to be doing something?
Not at all. It wasn't even like that. It was like, you know, Devontae dated Madonna for a long time, so me and her bumped into each other. I was doing a remix for Bobby Brown in the studio. And so she's like, yeah, why don't you just make a record while you at it, blah, blah. So me and my managers went to him and sat down and we took him a couple of songs. Like, yeah, just do a record. But it was the wrong label at the time. It was just, there wasn't R&B, and, you know, but it was more like we just went there with the situation and it was kind of little, you know, shaky from the beginning, but it was cool. It was fun doing it.
Should have seen backstage when we pulled up, got the limo. Babyface walked on. We wouldn't even speak to him. He was like, uh-oh, because we was walking in there, Jojo swinging a sword, and we got these face masks on.
Kick a ball, get a contract, earn a...
You know, music's changed much quicker now. It changes much quicker now than it did back in the day. You know, guys like Stevie, Marvin, and those guys had very long careers putting out. They changed their style, but, you know, they had their fan base for a couple of decades. Mm-hmm. It's much quicker moving now. If you get 5 years at the top in this day and age, you've done very, very well. Mm-hmm. In the time that Jodeci had stopped performing as Jodeci, around 96, I think it was, mm-hmm.
Yeah, 95.
Yeah, 95, 96. R&B started taking a big back seat to hip-hop. I know, you know. I mean, no longer were people like Tony Braxton selling 10 million albums.
Yeah,
you know, suddenly was, you know, you had your Busters went solo and then your Eminems, even Puffy. I couldn't believe Puffy could sell a record himself, but it just goes to show how big hip-hop became, you know?
Yeah,
that's not a diss, Puff, but, you know, it's true. But, you know, and I know you as a creative man must have been looking at this thinking, what's happening to the scene out there? Because you were doing a kind of a hip-hop R&B hybrid production sound, and all of a sudden everything sounded hip-hop. Even R&B cats were sounding, if you take their vocals off, you could put rap on it.
Yeah.
How did you feel? Did you feel you were going to fit into the scene? You know, you're going to, there was still a career for you singing R&B, or
I think everybody, you have to grow with the times or whatever else, you know what I'm saying? But Jodeci, like, we like, I'm trying to compare some, you understand, Bentley, you know what I'm saying? They don't change every 5, 2 years, 4 years, like a Ford, you know what I'm saying? We can last and keep doing our sound, and people appreciate just our sound, the original sound, what they're getting there. We might have to come out and change after 5 years, do a little tweak here and there, but it's still what you basically getting is Jodeci. And what you miss us for, that's what you're going to get. That's
what you're going to get. When you with your wife, your woman, your girlfriend, you get in the bed with, you don't want to put on a 50 Cent record, you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So that's never going to change. Anytime you want to make love, have sex, whatever you call it, you're going to want to hear something slow or something to put somebody in the mood, not to want to dance around your bedroom, you know what I'm saying?
That's true.
So it's like, that's always going to be needed, you know what I'm saying? It's like food. You always going to need food.
Every time I close my eyes, I wake up feeling so horny. I can't get you out of my mind.
Subtle about how you drop your lyrics on a record, I have to say. Mm. Certain records like I wanna you right. And you, and My Room, and I'm just remembering lyrics.
Yeah.
Let's Be Alone, and I Wanna Make You Moan, and you cut through all the suggestiveness and went straight there.
And we also went straight there with a positive song, with positive songs as well, man. Like, this song that You know, my mother, she listened to her music, but she only listened to the one that's talking about something.
Yeah.
Positive one, like Fell for My Lady. All that's talking about is a man just telling you, you're having my baby. I want you to be my lady.
Right.
So it's not talking about sex, but it's just talking about love. Our music is about love. And we like to write songs for people that don't want to hear I Want to Freak You. You know what I'm saying? But we also write songs for the people that want to hear I Want to Freak You. Or, you know, just and vice versa, man. And we try to make music for the world, man, everybody.
It was marketing genius when I first saw you. It's styled, the way you were styled. I thought some guy is just a genius.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? He said, mm-hmm. You guys got to look like this, you got to look like that. And then I saw you go up on an award show, and I nearly dropped my coffee, because I was watching TV and you had your tattoos out. No one had that at the time. Vest, someone had a sword, you had a big cigar, someone had a balaclava on.
Yeah.
I think one of you guys had a balaclava on or something.
Yeah, the army mask on.
Yeah, I had a
face mask on too. Yeah.
Now, if no one knew what music you sung, they wouldn't think you even sung. They would have thought you were some kind of mad metal, black rock.
Yeah, you should have seen backstage. We pulled up, got the limo. Babyface walked off. We wouldn't even speak to it. He was like, uh-oh, because he was walking in there, JoJo swinging his sword, and we got these face masks going.
What award show was this again?
The Billboard.
The Billboard Awards.
Yeah, that was
All American.
And we
Billboard
won that
awards,
night.
Yeah.
We won five that night. And we won five.
You won five? I bet they invited you back.
Yeah.
No.
It was actually something behind that. Because they didn't want any black artists to perform at these awards.
Mm.
We always win all the awards, but they wouldn't let us perform. Or when they performed, they give us like 5 minutes for like seven black artists. Mm. So that's what it was, and these rock artists are going for 15 minutes apiece. You know, it was just the black sector was just maybe like 10 minutes at the most. They would stick everybody on the stage together. Because I think they put like H-Town and SWV. Mm-hmm. It's that year when all of them was like hot. And they had like a 7 minute segment for everybody to perform. Mm. Then you hear all these white groups that wasn't winning no awards, that was new artists, was performing like 10 minutes apiece. So that's what it was kind of like a protest.
Are you actually happy that situation's changed quite a lot in America?
Oh, yeah.
Black music
becomes so at the time, you would see, like, even at the Grammys, they would just list the black artists that won. They would never show them, you know, best new artists for black R&B. They would never show them winning an award. They just say the name across. You know, it was just like, you know, all
I
had to
tell. That's one thing I thank hip hop for. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, definitely.
It dominates.
It bulldozed its way in there.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah.
You know you've been compared to every boy band, man band, four piece that's ever come out in black music since you guys were born as a group, Jodeci. Is there anybody out there you ever looked at and said, yeah, they're all right, I wouldn't mind? Or do you look at everybody and just think, can't touch Jodeci? Can't touch
Jodeci. Can't nobody touch Jodeci, period.
I know you're going to say that, Devontae.
Yeah, it's real. What's real is what's real. Yeah. And I only speak real. I don't do a lot of talking. It's real. Nobody can touch Jodeci. I'm standing through the camera so everybody can hear me. Nobody can touch Jodeci. That's just what it is.
I think the mistake like, that people make.
We haven't put out an album in 10 years, and our fans are still there like they were 10 years ago. You know what I'm saying? Just to see us, I'm like, okay, we know what we bring to the game.
Mm.
And until like we get too old to do it, that's when it's going to be the next. It's like Michael's. Nobody really out here going to be able to do it. Michael Bentley's really gone. Okay, then we can really say, okay, that's the next Michael. But It's not another Jodeci right now.
And now you've been out on the road and you've seen that the fans are still there waiting for you. Do you have any regrets about not putting anything out in the last 10 years?
No, none whatsoever, man. We just, like I said earlier, man, we just blessed. You know what I'm saying? And when God start blessing you, man, just go on and accept it.
It's like absence makes the heart grow fonder.
There you go.
Exactly. A lot of people overdo it, overexploit, and they overdo it until you just get tired and full of them. That's what we didn't want to do.
That's
you
know exactly what I'm saying?
We wanted you to appreciate us. And then it got to a point where we didn't, because people was like, okay, that's just Jodeci again. So we paused and we stopped. Okay, all this hip-hop coming in, so we about to get caught up in that rush. Okay, we going to forget about Jodeci. We stopped. Let you know what's the real. You have to miss it for a minute.
It messed up a few R&B artists. You know, back in the 70s, disco, they said, killed the careers of a lot of great artists, like Curtis Mayfield to a degree, and people like that.
Yeah.
I would say a lot of great R&B singers got messed up by hip-hop as well, because they were lost in a bit of an abyss. What do? Do I jump on this guy's track? Do I put on my own material? You know what I mean? Saying the Jodeci's sound will always be there, it'll always be, but we've been waiting. We've read rumor after rumor, you're putting new music out, and we have been waiting. we've been telling the kids out there how important you were, but we ain't had nothing recently to show them. So, what are the plans?
I guess you have to get an album, you know what I'm saying?
Like I said in one interview, our last CD was called The Show, The After Party, in the Hotel. Okay, it took us 12 years to check out the hotel. We're back. When we go back home, we're going to finish mixing and mastering up our CD. You know, and hey, whatever comes to the table. But I know one thing, Jodeci's too. When we get back home, we're just going to just finish doing our album, man, and plan for the next tour for the U.S. You know, though they are heated at y'all. I'm letting you know that now. Because everybody I talked to, like, why y'all didn't come in first? Yeah. I said, hey, we want to be the Black Beatles. The Beatles started in America first. And then they came back home.
So you come tingling. We got love at last. Jodeci, Devontae.
Right. Yes, excuse me.
KC, Dalvin, and JoJo's not feeling well, by the way. He's up in his bedroom right now. Thank you for coming to the lick, and thanks for coming to MTV.
That's what he told you. JoJo told you if I'm feeling well, man, we kicked him out.
No, JoJo's always like that.
I wanna see Rump on He-Man.